In order to measure energy changes, what we'll be looking for is we'll be looking to measure the heat. We're looking for ways to measure the heat. You may recall from the previous video that the delta H, the enthalpy change, which is a form of energy, is equal to the heat at constant pressure. So what we're looking for is we're looking for a way to measure the heat that either flows into or out of a substance in order to get the enthalpy change for that substance. Well, it has been observed, we know that certain amounts of heat either flowing into or out of a system will cause temperature changes. A temperature is not a heat. Temperature does not mean the same thing as heat. Heat is a form of energy, but the temperature is a way to monitor the heat that either has flown into or out of a system. By monitoring the temperature of the system, you can tell whether or not the system has gained heat, the actual form of energy has flown into it. The temperature then will typically rise or release heat, and the temperature goes down. Now, as we go on and study energy changes, what we find is that sometimes the temperature doesn't change even when heat flows into or out of a system. But for now, we're going to be looking at systems in which if you put heat into it, the temperature rises. If the system releases heat, the temperature goes down. Remember we talked about the fact that the system either has heat flowing into it or out of it. We're only looking at the heat that flows into or out of the system. We're not worried about the work because we've essentially made the work zero. So the system, if the heat flows into it, the sign convention is that is a positive numerical value for heat. If heat flows out of the system to the surroundings, we call that a negative numerical amount of heat. And so what we need is we need a way to relate that change in temperature to the amount of heat. Well, the heat is proportional to that change in temperature. This is my proportional sign. The heat is proportional to the change in temperature of the system as it relates to something called the heat capacity. The heat capacity of a substance is its capacity to absorb heat or release heat. It usually has units of joules per degree Celsius. So the heat capacity is defined as the amount of energy, the joules, required to raise the temperature every 1 degree Celsius. And it's the joule is the unit of energy. It is the amount of energy required to get that or to elicit that temperature change. Now, depending on the size of the substance, the amount of the substance, I'll see different heat capacities. The amount of heat required to raise this purple box's temperature by 1 degree Celsius, the amount of heat that I have to put into it, will be smaller than the amount of heat that will be required to put into this purple box's, into this purple box, to get the temperature to go up by 1 degree Celsius. This is a much bigger amount of heat because the box is bigger. So the heat required to raise the temperature is also proportional to the amount of substance. And therefore, what we usually do is instead of defining a heat capacity, which we can do, we talk about a specific heat capacity. Now, the heat capacity symbol, a lot of textbooks will use a C for that. Some textbooks will also use a C for the specific heat capacity. Our current textbook uses a lowercase s. Just be mindful of the symbols used for the various variables. The specific heat capacity has units of joules per gram per degree Celsius. So the specific heat capacity is defined in terms of the mass of the object. And it's a very easy formula. The amount of heat required to raise or lower the temperature on an object is equal to the mass of that object times its specific heat capacity times the change in temperature for that object. This delta T is the change in temperature. If you are raising the temperature of an object by 1 degree Celsius, if you have 1 gram of substance, then the specific heat capacity is the joules per gram degree Celsius. The grams will cancel, the degree Celsius will cancel, and that is the amount of heat required to raise 1 gram of substances up by a temperature of 1 degree Celsius. Now, the specific heat capacity works in this fashion. We can think of the temperature going up, but it also relates to the amount of heat released when the temperature goes down. If you go to a lower temperature, if the temperature goes down, then the delta T term, which is some final minus some initial value, the delta T term will be negative, which means the Q value will also be negative. It'll be less than zero. What that means in that case is that heat has been released from the system, and that should make sense to you. If heat is flowing into the system, a positive amount of Q, then that means the temperature of the system is going up. If heat flows out of the system, we put a negative sign on the amount of Q, and that means the temperature of the system goes down. So watch your signs. The change in temperature, if you just think of it as an absolute value, you will numerically calculate the correct numerical value of Q, but your sign may be wrong. So you do want to keep track of your sign. Let's look at some examples of some specific heat capacities. We can Google these. So let's look at a table of specific heat capacities on the internet. All right, this is a pretty good example. You can find lots and lots and lots of these tables. You do have to be a little careful of the units. And these are experimental values. They are measured values. And so you will sometimes find tables that list slightly different values. For example, this one has aluminum as 0.900. You might find a specific heat capacity of aluminum that's slightly different than this. We see a variety of things. There's copper at 0.385. Again, you might find a table with slightly different values. Here we have water. Liquid water is 4.184 joules per gram degree Celsius, and that is commonly accepted. You'll notice that looks awfully familiar. That is our equivalence between calories and joules. One calorie equals 4.184 joules, and so the original calorie was defined as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of water by 1 degree Celsius, but then it was later defined in terms of the joule. The joule is the standard now, and so there's an exact definition that 4.184 joules equals 1 calorie. All right, so those are values for specific heat or specific heat capacity. And again, be careful. Some places will put slightly different symbols. Just go with whatever's in your textbook. Also, we sometimes will simply refer to this as the specific heat rather than the specific heat capacity. But the bottom line is the formula is Q equals MS delta T. In this particular formula, you have 4 variables. There is a variable for the heat. There is a variable for the mass of the substance, the specific heat of the substance, and the change in temperature. And typically, the way that this problem is worded is if you are given one of these 4 to find, then you're given enough information or data for the other 3 variables, and you simply solve this algebraic expression.